Yeah. So we're going to continue discussing this ninth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Remember, the ninth chapter is the heart of the Bhagavad Gita. The middle portion of the Gita, chapter 7 to 12, are speaking of devotional service. And chapter 9 is entitled The Most Confidential Knowledge. So we're hearing in that section of the dealings, the transcendental relationship which the Lord has with His devotees. So yesterday we explained how the chapter begins, Krishna describing qualifications for hearing this knowledge. Right? We spoke about the three qualifications, right? One was, first we should be not envious, right? Krishna said to Arjuna, because you're not envious of me, Arjuna, I'm speaking this knowledge to you. So Prabhupada talked about the commentators on Bhagavad Gita who derived Krishna as being the personality of Godhead. So they're all envious of Krishna. So they're not qualified to comment on the Bhagavad Gita. Like so many interpretations, speculators present their commentary on the Bhagavad Gita of no value. And then another qualification we said was generous, right? Like a king, right? Because the king of knowledge, Rajaguyam, most confidential knowledge. But kings are generous. They give. They like to give. They like to give charity. And the greatest charity is to give transcendental knowledge. So to give this knowledge to others is also very good. Share this knowledge. And then finally, the other qualification was?
Faith.
Right. You have to have faith. Faith can move mountains, right? Without faith, then we will simply have doubts. So it's important for us to have these qualifications, and we can understand this confidential knowledge. So Krishna then begins to explain the relationship which he has with the material world, the relationship between the Lord and the material energy. And he describes how he pervades everything in this world by his avyakta murtina. Right? Mayantukam idam sarvam jagat avyakta murtina. Krishna said, by me this entire universe is pervaded. All beings are in me, but I am not in them. So Krishna is everywhere. He's in everything, but he's not in them. So Krishna is describing the presence of his energy, how by his energy he's pervading everything. But at the same time, he is aloof from it. Sometimes we speak about God being everywhere. But if God is simply everywhere, then it becomes impersonalism. So we have to be on guard against these kind of statements. People talk, oh, God is everywhere. He's everything and everyone. This is impersonalism. Yes, He is everywhere and in everything and in everyone. But at the same time, He is aloof from everything. He remains a person beyond this cosmic manifestation. So this is the Lord's relationship with the world. And the example, we give the example, just like a king rules a kingdom. So within the king's management structure, he may have many different ministers looking after the different departments within his kingdom. But the king doesn't have to personally be there in each and every department. He empowers different ministers to act on his behalf. You remember last night we gave the example from the commentary of Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. He spoke about Maharaj Ambarish, how he was a great king. But he didn't spend so much of his time worrying about the political affairs, because he was a very great devotee. So he liked to be in the temple, he liked to be hearing the scriptures, taking part in the kirtan, all of these things. But because he's there, because he's physically present, because he's a king, so everything would go on under his direction, so to speak. The different ministers would all act on behalf of the king. So in the same way, Krishna is doing everything, but at the same time, he's aloof from everything. He's not attached to it. And Krishna gave himself, he gave an example for us to understand this. We point out that Krishna was describing something inconceivable, but he gives an example for us to conceive of it. So it appears contradictory. Krishna gave an example about how the wind blows everywhere, but it is always within space. Right? Wherever the wind blows, it can never go without space. It has to be within space itself, although the wind is blowing everywhere. In the same way, living entities, we are fully dependent on Krishna. He's providing everything for us. Everything is his arrangement. It's all going under his control. He's maintaining us, providing for us, arranging for everything. But at the same time, we are independent. This is Lord Chaitanya's philosophy. Ajinya veda abheda tattva. Inconceivably, simultaneously one, and at the same time different. And some examples were given about how Krishna is controlling everything. The example was there of the flower and the fragrance from the flower, the smelling power. One can smell the fragrance of the flower without actually handling the flower. You can just, by passing by the flower bed, you may be able to detect the aroma, the fragrance of the flower. So in the same way, Krishna is controlling this whole cosmic manifestation, but at the same time, he's aloof from it. He's separate from it. He doesn't have to do each and every detail himself. It all goes on by his will. So in this way, Krishna was describing how he's doing everything. The Bhagavad Gita describes, for example, how Krishna is not only maintaining, but how he's also arranging for the creation and the destruction of the universe. That's also going on under his direction. And we are all influenced by all of these different things. Okay? So, Krishna was describing this Yogam Aishwaram. I'm sorry, the phonetics are not right, the fonts are wrong. Anyway, consider it his Yogam Aishwaram. Why doesn't everyone respect Krishna as the Supreme Person? Right? Because Krishna was, he was describing there to us how he pervades everything and he has this inconceivable potency, this Yogam Aishwaram, his by which he's doing everything, controlling, maintaining everything, all going on under his direction. So, we may think everyone should worship Krishna. Everyone should know. Yeah, he's so great. Why doesn't everyone worship him? So then Krishna spoke the next verse, which we're going to look at. First of all, let's take one at a time. verses 11 and 12 of this chapter speak about the impersonalists. First of all, we have the famous verse, Abhijananti Mammunha Manushin Tanam Ashratam. Right? Krishna is describing the foolish mock at me descending amongst them like an ordinary human being. They do not know my transcendental nature and supreme dominion over all that be. This is an important verse. You can tell Prabhupada wrote 3 pages of purport there on that verse just to enforce, to bring home clearly the importance and the significance of this statement. That these people who think like that, they're described as mudhas, right? Foolish people. So, Krishna is talking about the impersonalists. They think they can become God. They think they're God, but they've been covered by Maya. So we generally call them Mayavadis, right? That they've been covered by Maya. So they, but when they think, when I remove the Maya, when I understand all this is just Maya, then I'll realize I'm actually God. So this is impersonalism, that everyone is God. Actually, it's true, we were discussing this morning with Srimad Bhagavatam, that actually everyone is a god. We're tiny gods, sample gods. We're not supreme gods. We're tiny parts of God. So this is important. So impersonalism, Prabhupada's mission, Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Academy, delivering people, particularly the Western world, just like Malaysia follows the Western world, right? Delivering people from impersonalism and voidism. Very, very strong, very powerful influence on people. Impersonalism and voidism, the desire to become God. And why should we want to become God? Because then we can do anything we like. We don't have to follow any rules and regulations. Because we think, I'm God. I can do what I like. Don't tell me what to do. So Prabhupada has to teach us how to defeat this impersonalism, this nonsense, bogus philosophy. So Krishna describes these people are foolish. They think Krishna is an ordinary person. They think he's an ordinary human being. They do not understand his transcendental nature and his supreme dominion over all that be. So that's text 11. And then text 12 describes the result of that kind of thinking. The result is, whatever they're going to do, they will never be successful. All of their efforts for fruitive activity or speculative knowledge, whatever they try to do, they will never succeed. So this impersonalism is discussed here in 2 slokas. Then, verses 13 and 14, Krishna speaks about the pure devotees. Those who do recognize Krishna and who surrender to him and who engage in his service. Right? They're described as Mahatmas, great souls. Their souls are great because they recognize the Supreme Soul and they've surrendered themselves to His service. And then, verses 16, 17, 18, 19 describe about the worship, those who worship the Vishwarup, the universal form. They see God through the material world. That's described also in Srimad Bhagavatam in 2nd Canto, beginning of the... it's described in 2nd Canto. Anyway, described in Srimad Bhagavatam how the materialistic people, they're not able to understand the Lord in the deity. They can only see the world or the universe as a form of God. And they worship the world, they worship the whole universe as being the body of God. We speak about the trees as being hairs on the body of God, and the rivers as being veins on the body of God. Then the sun is like the eye of the Lord, and all the different planets, they're all representing different bones in the body of the Lord. So in this way, the whole structure of the universe is compared to the anatomy of the Supreme Lord. People cannot see God in the deity, they see God through the universe. So they see Krishna, they're worshipping Krishna, but in a different way. So that's 16 to 19. And then, after describing those who worship the universal form, there are others who see God in many different forms, appearing in many different ways. And they're worshipping actually demigods, or devas, what we call in Malaysia as devas. But Prabhupada generally more clearly defines them as demigod worshippers. They worship the Lord in these different forms. Okay. So here's the famous verse speaking about impersonalism. Lord Krishna is very strong in describing these people. Calls them mudhats, or foolish people, because they cannot understand the transcendental nature of Krishna's body. Of course, Krishna appears like a human being. We appear, it's not that Krishna appears like us, we have taken the form of Krishna, right? Where man is made in the image of God, it's not that God is made in the image of man. First there is God, and we have taken the form of God. So Krishna appears in his human form, and people think he's an ordinary person. People also think Krishna took birth. They think Krishna died. They think he got shot in the foot by a hunter. Did you ever hear of anybody dying because he got shot in the foot? But this is the ignorance of the foolish people. So foolish people, they do not understand Krishna's transcendental position. Here's a statement from Vishwanath Chakrabarti Thakur in his commentary on this verse. He's describing that well-known Mahapurush laying on the Karana ocean with Satchidananda form, right? The form of the Lord is Satchidananda, spreading himself through millions of universes, who creates the universe by his own energy, is indeed you. But some say in deprecation that when you come as the son of Vasudeva, human-like form, it is just an amsha of that Mahapurush. In response, the Lord speaks this verse. So, Vishwanath Chakrabarti Thakur is saying that some people think that Krishna is an amsha of Mahavishnu, that it's Mahavishnu who is the Supreme Lord. So sometimes people think like that. They think Narayan is the Supreme, not Krishna. Yes, they derive this human-like form that I assume, Krishna is speaking. They do not know that this human-like body is the supreme form, Parabrahman, Baba. It is my swarup, my actual form, more attractive than and superior to the Mahapurush laying in the Karana ocean and other forms as well. What type of form is this? It is the highest truth, meaning Brahman, and it is the great Lord, The phrase "Great Lord" excludes other meanings of the word Buddha. According to Amatosh, Buddha has various meanings, such as truth, the elements like air, or being fit. So Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur is pointing out how the form of Krishna is more attractive than the form of Mahavishnu, the Mahapurush, laying in the Karanadak ocean. There's a pastime in the 10th canto Srimad Bhagavatam how Mahavishnu wanted to see the form of Lord Krishna. The story goes about how one Brahmana's wife was giving birth to children in Dwarka. And what? So the Brahmana came to protest to the king. And the king promised, "I will protect you." Oh, Arjuna was here, and Arjuna said, "I'm a Kshatriya, I will protect you, I vow. If I cannot keep my vow, I will give up my life." And so when the Brahmana's wife gave birth again there was a miscarriage. And so the Brahmana came and, "Look, you promised you were going to protect my child. Again, the child's dead. You promised you would protect." So then Arjuna was faced with a real challenge because he had vowed he would give up his life. So Srimad Bhagavatam describes how Krishna and Arjuna went together to search out what had happened to the Brahmana's children. And the search took them into the Kaushal ocean, and they found Mahavishnu there. And the children had been taken away by the mystic potency of Mahavishnu, who actually desired to see Lord Krishna come there into his abode. So this pastime shows us how even Mahavishnu is attracted to see the form of Lord Krishna. So this point is made here in the commentary that Krishna is more attractive even than the Mahapurush Mahavishnu. Okay, 9.12 goes on to describe the results of this misconceiving Lord Krishna to be an ordinary human being. The result is that whatever you do, you'll be a failure. You can never hope to succeed. Although it may appear like people are successful, ultimately they can never succeed. Everything will be a failure because they have not understood the actual position of Lord Krishna. So they can never be successful. And Prabhupada gives some examples here. We have a quotation. First of all, from the commentary, "What is the destination of those who do not accept you, Krishna, as the Lord, and think that you have a human material body? Even if devotees are in this condition, their aspirations are in vain. Mogasha. They do not achieve salokya." Salokya means liberation into becoming a resident on the same planet with the Lord in the spiritual sky, or whatever else they have desired. If they are karmis, they do not attain the desired result of their actions, such as swarg, going to heaven, moga kamana. If they are jnanis, they do not attain the result of knowledge, liberation, moga jnana. What do they attain? They assume the nature of rakshasas. Not a very nice destination, right? This is the result of their misconception. Moga karmana means fruitless, baffled. Whatever they are doing something, but at the end, they will find it frustration. They are not happy. Take, for example, we have practical experience in India. Mahatma Gandhi. He was a great worker for national emancipation. But at the end, he was so much disgusted. That I have seen personally. Wherever he used to go,
he used to plug his ears. Why? Wherever he would go, thousands of people would gather and cry, Mahatma Gandhi ki jai. So the poor fellow could not sleep even. The very morning when he was assassinated, he said to his secretary, I am so disgusted, I wish to die. He got his wish. This very word was published in the paper. Such a big worker, but still he felt baffled. And what to speak of others? So, moga karmana. Unless we become Krishna conscious, then all our activities will be baffled in the end. Right? So this warning is given to all of us, that endeavoring to become successful in the material world, if it is without Krishna consciousness, then we can never be successful. There are so many examples, powerful demons, Ravan, Aranyakashipu, Aranyaksha, these kind of people, Kamsa. They were very powerful, but they were not Krishna conscious, so they cannot be successful. Okay, going on to the next section about the devotees, the Mahatmas, the great souls. Those who are not deluded, right? They're not deluded. They're under the protection of the divine nature. Mahatmanas tumam partha daivim prakriti mashrita. Right? We talk about ashraya, taking shelter. Ashraya. So take shelter of the daivi prakriti, the divine nature. What? By devotional service. And how do they do that? They are fully engaged in devotional service. Because they know me as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, original and inexhaustible. So these are Mahatmas, devotees. All the devotees are Mahatmas, great souls, engaged in Krishna conscious activity. Prabhupada explains here, all the word, from the word meaning. Vajanti ananya manaso. They do not direct their attention to anything outside of Krishna. This is very important. They don't divert to other things. They're fully absorbed in Krishna's service. Ananya Bhakti. Remember yesterday we were speaking about the connection between chapter 8 and chapter 9? In chapter 8, Krishna was speaking about Ananya Bhakti. Now in chapter 9, Krishna is describing this Ananya Bhakti. We will hear more of the nature of this Ananya Bhakti in the next verse. From Prabhupada's purport, in this verse, the description of Mahatma is clearly given. The first sign of a Mahatma is that he is already situated in the divine nature. The guidance of the spiritual nature is called Daivi Prakriti. So when one is promoted in that way, by surrendering to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, one attains to the stage of a great soul, Mahatma. Mahatma does not divert his attention to anything outside of Krishna, because he knows perfectly well that Krishna is the original Supreme Person, the cause of all causes. There is no doubt about it. Such a Mahatma develops through association with other Mahatmas, pure devotees. They are simply attracted by the two-armed form of Krishna. Sometimes Prabhupada will be more liberal, but here in this particular case, he talks about simply attracting them. How is he engaged? What's he doing? In the next
verse, number 14, describes always chanting my glories, endeavoring with determination, bowing down before me. These great souls perpetually worship me with devotion. So this is what you have to do to be Mahatma, what you should be doing. Dridhavrat is mentioned. Vow, determined vow. Strictly observe rules and regulations. Vows like Ekadasi. Right? You should be careful to follow these things. In the beginning of our Krishna consciousness movement, we were not so familiar, so knowledgeable. But nowadays, we're very fortunate, especially here. You have Goloka Chakraprabhu publishing his calendar with all the times, the courtesy time, what time to break the fast and everything. So, everything's very good. Followed nicely with the Dridhavrat, right? Determined vow. Worship Krishna and Kashra. Tata Dham Kirti Yantama. Or in personalist, they also do kirtan. But with our kirtans to be, will certainly be different from the impersonalists. Just like these impersonalists, they do kirtan, they'll chant any name. They can chant Hare Krishna 1 minute, next minute they're chanting Shiva, they're chanting Ganesha. Chant of also many different names. We read in the Srimad Bhagavatam how in Narada Muni's previous life as a Gandharva, he was cursed by the Prajapatis for chanting the names of the demigods in the association of young women. So I have to be very careful how you chant, the quality in our chant. Okay, Mahatma, Prabhupada is describing, cannot be manufactured by rubber stamping. His symptoms are described, always engaged in chanting, he has no other business. Always engaged in activity such as hearing, chanting about Vishnu, not a demigod or a human being. Such a Mahatma has firm determination to achieve the ultimate end of association with the Lord in any of the five rasas. Okay, so this is different statements. Prabhupada's example, the figure of Mahatma. We can see in Srila Prabhupada's life how he personified that Mahatma. He was chanting by constantly preaching the message of Krishna. Chanting is not just only chanting japa and kirtan, but speaking about Krishna. That is also kirtan. So Prabhupada did a lot of kirtan, and his kirtan was also his books, writing his books. That was also kirtan, because from his book, so much kirtan is still going on today. So this is Prabhupada showed us the behavior of the Mahatma, constantly chanting the glories of the Lord, and very determined how he minimized his eating and sleeping. He was only sleeping 2 hours a day, waking up in the middle of the night to write his books. Because all day, so many devotees, so many different visitors coming. So Prabhupada, the best time to write for him was in the night. And he would wake up in the middle of the night and begin his writing. So Prabhupada was showing us the behavior of Mahatma. At the same time, Prabhupada was not taking anything for himself. He was giving everything to Krishna. So he showed us how to dedicate our life for the service of Krishna. 9:15. It's a significant verse in this chapter, because in the 15th verse, it begins with Anye. I'll read the verse to you. What Krishna is speaking, he's summarizing the chapter for us. And he says, others, jnana yaktena chapi anye, anye meaning others. So, Krishna is describing about different people, other people, how they worship Krishna in different ways. Now, earlier in the 7th chapter, Krishna had described about those who surrender to him. He described they have sukriti, right? And for different reasons they come to him. Chatur vidabhitam himam jnana sukriti no arjuna. Ato jignasur artarti jnani ja bharatashava. Krishna describes four kinds of pious people who surrender to him. Somebody is in distress, someone in search of wealth, somebody who's curious, and others in search of knowledge. So they're not pure devotees, but they're pious people. They have sukriti. That sukriti brought them to devotional service. And we spoke earlier, we just finished speaking about the Mahatmas. They are pure devotees. They're fully engaged in Krishna consciousness. So below them, you've got the four kinds of people who have sukriti, and they come to Krishna consciousness. But now, Krishna is speaking about others who are still lower, right? We spoke already about the monists. They worship themselves as one with the Lord, right? Impersonalism, Mayavadi. They're described as the lowest. Third class. They're the most predominant, very common philosophy. People think we're all God. I used to think it was God. Right? When I first went to the temple, they said, do you know who's God? I said, I'm God. You're God. We're all God. That was what I'd been taught. I'd read books of all the Mayavadis. I read these different yogis' books, and that's what they were all speaking. So I didn't know, but the devotees defeated me. So, monists, they worship themselves as one with God. That's described in verses 11 and 12. And then, we will hear about Kritakvena Bahuda. In other words, demigod worship. Many different forms. They think God comes in many different forms, different features. And this is, they concoct these different forms. And they think it's all a means to ultimately the oneness. So this is demigod worship, leads to impersonalism. And that is described also in the 9th chapter, verses 20 to 25. But before that, we will hear about those who worship the universal form. Vishvato Mukham, right? The many faces. Seeing God in the universe. Recognizing everything in relation to the form of the Lord. The material world is a form of God. So that's another form. This, again, is lower. These people, they don't have the sukriti to directly think up bhakti yoga like these other four kinds of people who were described in the 7th chapter. So these different people are going to be described for us. Indirect worshippers, right? We're speaking. People worship these different forms, different demigods.
The prophet, right, prophet speaking. Now those who are directly worshipping the Supreme Lord, Sri Krishna, they have been described as Mahatma. And there are others, worshippers. They cannot conceive of the Supreme Personality of Godhead directly on account of being less advanced. Therefore, they have been described here, Anye, others. So others, they worship the Absolute Truth in three different ways. First class, second class, and third class, right? So, you can go back again, you can see this one. First class, this is worshipping the demigods. Second class, the universal form. Third class, the monads, impersonals. Different commentators explain it differently. The Prabhupada explains it. He sees impersonalism as being the lowest, the worst. So verses 16 to 25, describing Krishna as a supreme form of worship. Seeing Krishna in the universe, it's all described. You can read some of the verses. Krishna is describing text 16. But it is I who am the ritual, I the sacrifice, the offering to the ancestors, the healing herb, the transcendental chant. I am the butter and the fire and the offering. I am the father of this universe, the mother, the support, and the grandsire. I am the object of knowledge, the purifier, and the syllable Om. I am also the Rig, Sama, and the Yajurveda. I am the goal, the sustainer, the master, the witness, the abode, the refuge, and the most dear friend. I am the creation and the annihilation, the basis of everything, the resting place, and the eternal seat. O Arjuna, I give heat, and I withhold, and send forth the rain. I am immortality, and I am also death personified. Both spirit and matter are in me. Okay? So Krishna is describing here the universal form. All everything is there within the universal form. Okay, we'll go ahead. Then there's a couple of verses about worshipping the Vedas and how people can get material desire. 20-21, describing about worshipping demigods to get material benefits, to enjoy heavenly life. And then Krishna speaks number 22, which is a well-known verse, famous verse, often spoken about and often described. Yoga, particularly the last line there. Yoga kshima vahami aham, right? Krishna says, I carry what you lack, I preserve what you have. Oh, we like this. This sounds very encouraging for us. Oh, Krishna's going to help me. Yeah? But who does he do this for? Not just for anyone, but for those who are qualified. The qualification is, those who always worship me with exclusive devotion, meditating on my transcendental form, then for them, I carry what you lack. I preserve what you lack. So if we want to get that kind of reciprocation from Krishna, we have to qualify. That's the qualification.
Lord Prabhupada often would tell the story about Arjunacharya and how he crossed out the Bahami. He thought Krishna wouldn't do it himself. He thought it must be Karomiyaham. He said, I will arrange somebody to do it. Krishna wouldn't personally do it. But what happened was, Krishna personally came there and brought all the food and everything, gave them to the brahmana's wife, and convinced the brahmana that actually Krishna personally comes and takes care of the devotee. So he does this as his reciprocation with his devotee. But we have to qualify, we have to be like that. We have to meditate on Krishna. We have to be devotee. Vishwanath Chakravarti's commentary, he said, on the other hand, the happiness of my Ananya Bhaktas is given by me. It is not obtained by pious acts. Right? The happiness the devotee gets, it's given by Krishna. It's not just good karma. The happiness, somebody's pleasure in life, it, for the devotee, it's arranged by Krishna. They are at all times well versed in matters concerning me and are always ignorant of all other things. Or the phrase given that they constantly desire to be in my association. For such persons, I take care of their attainment of wealth and their maintenance, though they do not expect such things. It would be unsuitable for the Lord simply to say that he performs his acts. Thus the word Bahami, meaning carry, is used. The use of the word Bahami indicates that the Lord bears the burden of maintaining their bodies in the manner that the householder takes the responsibility for maintaining his wife and children. Thus one should say that like others, their attainment or preservation of bodily needs is due to karma. One should not say like that. So the devotee understands the arrangement of Krishna. And similarly, the suffering, not only the happiness, but the suffering of a devotee is also the arrangement of Krishna. Someone may argue, still, you are Atmarama, enjoying within, indifferent to all things. Where is the question of you bearing this responsibility? So Krishna replies, because my Ananya devotee has no karma due to lack of desire, his happiness is given by me. Though I am indifferent to all else, I have great affection for my devotee. This is the cause. One should also not say that in giving the burden of their maintenance to the Lord, the devotees show a lack of praying. In fact, they do not give to me that burden. Rather, I, by my own will, accept it. It should also be understood that I am not bearing it as a duty in the matter that I create and maintain the universe by my will alone. Rather, being attached to my devotees, I take the greatest pleasure in taking care of their needs, like carrying the weight of one's lover. So this is very confidential knowledge. Krishna's loving relationship with his devotee. How the devotee doesn't ask Krishna, he's not appealing to Krishna, but Krishna wants to do this. Krishna wants to provide this service. And you may have some have had some experiences yourself where we've actually experienced Krishna taking care, providing for us. Why is it not a burden for Krishna to maintain his devotees? It's not a burden for Krishna. It's so easy for Krishna to do this. He can do it without any consideration. Because when we want to do something also, when we have a strong feeling of attachment and desire to want to help, it's not difficult. We want to do something, we have that desire, then it becomes very easy for us. So for Krishna also, we have many examples how Krishna provides, takes care for the devotees, how he's arranging for everyone. Particularly the devotees in the beginning, they had no money, whatever, but still somehow, you can read, I was reading Shamsundar's book about hunting rhinos with the Swamiji. And it's amazing, so wonderful how they lived there in London. In 1969, 68, they came there to England practically with no money at all. And Shamsundar and Malati had a young child also. But somehow, you know, they did so many wonderful things. You know, they met George Harrison, he made the record, they opened the record for them. They made the Hare Krishna mantra recording, went all over the world. World famous. Krishna just arranged all these things very easily because they were so surrendered to Krishna. So there are many examples. The devotees, when they first came to Malaysia, what was the name? Janaki and her husband? Ramcharan, right? Ramcharan, right? They came here, Yadubara and his wife Vishaka, and then, no, they came here. And there were no temples, there were no devotees, but they were here, they were preaching. Amoga came, Hanuman, but Prabhupada came that time first, before any of them. Amoga came here with Hanuman Swami, and Prabhupada then came, went, they did programs. How did they do it? Krishna helps them. Surrender to Krishna. Okay, another 9:23, the next verse goes on. But something, not everyone's worshipping Krishna. What about those who are not worshipping Krishna? Those who are devotees of other gods, they worship them with faith. They actually worship only me. But they do so in a wrong way. Right? Abhidhi purvakam. They're actually worshipping Krishna because these demigods are also servants of Krishna and they are tiny parts of Krishna. They're acting under the direction of Krishna. So when they worship these other demigods, they're actually worshipping Krishna, but they're doing it in the wrong way, not pleasing to him. Prabhupada explains in the purport, one has to follow the laws made by the government, not by the officers or directors. Right? The demigods, the different devas, these are like the officers and directors. Similarly, everyone is to offer his worship to the Supreme Lord only. That will automatically satisfy the different officers and directors of the Lord. The officers and directors are engaged as representatives of the government. And to offer some bribe to the officers and directors is illegal. This is stated here as avidhi purvakam. In other words, Krishna does not approve the unnecessary worship of the demigods. Important information for people here in Malaysia, right? A lot of demigod worship goes on here. people don't know that this is Abhidhi Purvakam. They're not familiar with the message of Bhagavad Gita. They chant so many other things. They don't know Bhagavad Gita. They have to preach more. Keep preaching.
Worship demigods. May be accepted.
If people know that these demigods are authorized agents of the Supreme Lord,
that is acceptance of the Lord. But these fools who do not accept the Supreme God and misunderstand that this particular type of demigod is all in all,
they are doing nonsense.
They are placing so many competitors of the Lord. That is Abhidhi Purvakam.
That is illegal.
Nobody can be a competitor of the Supreme Lord. The Supreme Lord is known as Asama Urva. Nobody is greater than the Supreme Lord, and nobody is equal.
So like this Prabhupada speaking very strongly against the worship of the demigods. Certainly in Bhagavad Gita this is condemned. But at the same time, we can worship the demigods if we understand properly their position, that they are agents, representatives of the Supreme Lord. They are not supreme.
9:25.
Those who would be thinking, well, does it make any difference if I worship the demigods, if I worship Krishna? Well, you get a different result. You worship the demigods, you go to the planets of the demigods. You worship Krishna, you go to be with him. It does make a difference. Of course, people often talk, it's all one, it's all the same. And even there was this famous Bengali man, he had the Bengali saying, Yataman Katapat. Many paths, many months, many paths, right? In other words, it doesn't matter where you go, it's all the same, all the gods are one. All bogus, all nonsense. Now, this is not confirmed from Bhagavad Gita. You worship the demigods, you go to the demigods. You worship the Supreme Lord, you can go to his abode. Now, if you go to the planets of the demigods, you're still in the material world. You're still facing birth and death. Prabhupada speaks again very strongly. She's a prostitute.
That's all. Krishna says, Yanti Deva Pratadivan. How, you nonsense, say that everyone goes to God.
This is nonsense.
You can go to Shiva. You can go to Indra. You can go. There are many planets.
And you go there.
That is reasonable. And how do you say that whatever ticket I purchase,
I go to this Delhi?
Therefore they are nonsense, mudhas, rascals. They do not know what is God, what is demigod, what is Lord Shiva, what is Lord Vishnu or Brahma. They do not know.
Prabhupada said, just like if a woman says, everyone is my husband, then she is a prostitute. That's all. Probably
very interesting way of presenting it.
The 9:26, the famous verse, important verse. We'll finish on this verse, but very important verse. Patram Pushpam Palam Prayam. Krishna is explaining how we can please him, how the process of bhakti yoga is so easy. Can offer these simple things. And of course it's not the offering which is important, but what is important
is the devotion. Just like you can see in this verse, bhaktya is mentioned there.
Bhaktya. I was just reading also Prabhupada was speaking on this verse, and he was saying that he said not just anyone can offer to Krishna. Krishna won't accept. He said, you want to offer to Krishna, you have to be chanting. If you're not chanting, Krishna will not accept. And Prabhupada even said, you should be initiated. You're going to offer to Krishna. He said, those who are initiated should offer. Krishna won't accept from just anyone. And also it talks about devotion. This devotion, Prabhupada, in one of the commentaries by the Acharya, he talks about the importance of cleanliness. He said, when the woman is contaminated, she can't make offering. She's not clean. She shouldn't be offering to the deities in contaminated state. So, because bhakti means also devotion, we'll care about our cleanliness. If we're not pure, then we can't offer to Krishna. So many requirements are there. Of course, the devotion is important. The example is there, Vidura is giving the banana skins to Krishna. Krishna came to his house and he's so excited. He threw away the bananas and gave Krishna the banana skins. But Krishna thought, he's my devotee, he's offering with love. Krishna accepted. But when Vidura, or when Duryodhan offered and cooked a big meal with best ghee and everything, then Krishna didn't want. So somebody asked me, one of the Chinese devotees, they were saying to me that, you know, if somebody offers to Krishna, why doesn't he accept? An interesting question, you know. Why doesn't, you know, somebody's offering to Krishna, why Krishna won't accept? But the point is that they're not devotees. Duryodhana was not a devotee. Krishna said to Duryodhana, if you're envious of the Pandavas, then you're envious of me. If the Pandavas are your enemy, then I must also be your enemy. So Krishna doesn't want to accept things from the enemies. Why not? Because the enemies have their motives. They want to do harm to the devotees. They don't have a good heart. They will give to Krishna, but they want Krishna to bring some harm against his devotees. They have their motives. The demons, they have their motives. Just like Harani Kashyapu is worshipping Brahma. Why? He has his motive, you know. He wants to be immortal. Why does he want to be immortal? He wants to conquer and enjoy. He wants to enjoy, take over heaven. He wants all the material power, sense gratification. We all have so many material desires, demonic desires. So therefore, Krishna does not encourage these kind of people. They're not devotees. So why should we accept any? Of course, we give people a chance to become devotees. There's a lot of people in the street, just like when they go out on the street and distribute books. Now, are we going to give a book to somebody who's not a devotee? Yeah, we would do. We give them the chance to become a devotee. But Krishna personally, he doesn't have to accept anymore. But devotees are more merciful than Krishna. Krishna doesn't, because they're against the devotees. But the devotee is more merciful than Krishna. Just like Lord Chaitanya was ready to kill Jagai Madai, but Lord Nityananda pleaded with him, no, you have to be merciful in this age. Give them a chance to become devotees. Okay? So, we will stop here. Any questions? Yes? Andrew, yeah? You want to? Can somebody tell me what you're saying? why is it important? It is one of his qualifications as Bhagavan that he can renounce. We're very attached to everything in this world. We're very attached. But Krishna is not attached. He's aloof from everything. He can be detached. Because it's all his. He is the controller of everything. So he doesn't have to worry about it. We're very attached. We're all trying to acquire things, get more power, get more wealth, become more successful in material life. We have so many ambitions and plans. Krishna doesn't have any of these things. So Krishna is aloof from all of that. He's not attached. We are. That's the difference between him and us. He is Bhagavan. We are not. Does it make sense? Think about it. But Krishna doesn't have to be attached. This is his opulence. It's inconceivable. You have to think about it more. Just like when Krishna was in Dwarka with Rukmini, you know, they were grandparents, but Krishna was teasing Rukmini, and at one point he told Rukmini, you know, I'm not worthy to be your husband, and, you know, you should marry somebody else. And Rukmini fainted at first. But when she recovered, then she began to speak, and she began to praise Krishna. And Krishna had been speaking that, you know, I'm not qualified, and I'm, you know, my background is unknown, and you're a princess, you're the daughter of a great king, you're from a royal family, I'm simply from the village, I'm a cowherd boy, I'm not really qualified to be a husband for you. But then Rukmini began to speak more about Krishna, because she understood Krishna. She understood Krishna's identity, and she could properly glorify him. So she described how, you know, you say that all of these other kings are more eligible than you. But who are these kings? These kings are all defeated by time. But you're never defeated by time. You control time. You are time. Time is one of your forms. Everything is your energy. Like this. These other kings are all servants of their senses. But you're the controller. You're the master. You're the proprietor of the senses. So this is Krishna's inconceivable offering. Okay, Hare Krishna. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada.